Hey friends, you know the SQL Server team is going all in on Jupyter Notebooks with support for SQL, and PowerShell, and Python Notebooks, and Azure Data Studio. And now the SQL Server team is shipping the internal troubleshooting guides used by actual Microsoft engineers as Jupyter Books. They're making them available to the general public. And Vicky Harp is here to show me what's new today on Azure Friday. Hi, I'm Scott Hanselman, and it is Azure Friday. I'm here with Vicky Harp. There's a lot of stuff going on in SQL Server, and apparently I'm out of the loop. Last time I was an expert in SQL Server was about 10, 15 years ago.
Well, we just announced a GA of SQL Server 2019 back at Ignite. Okay. And so there is a lot going on, both in SQL Server as a platform, mm-hmm. on cloud and on-prem and in hybrid, and then in our tooling approaches to it as well. So, probably, what was the tool that you probably used last
time? Well, we used SQL Management Studio. Mm-hmm. It was kind of a Visual Studio looking thing. Mm-hmm. And we would basically just have folders full of .SQL files. Mm-hmm. And we had a bunch that we built up as a group. And our shared knowledge was usually a readme.txt, mm-hmm. and a SQL file, or maybe a SQL file with some comments.
And then where were you running your tooling and your SQL Server?
We were running it on a Windows server, mm-hmm. in a data center on the third floor, mm-hmm. that you could go down and visit, and mm-hmm. you could touch it, and it was a real computer. Mm-hmm. And we were doing all of the running of the work on our local machines with connection strings that were probably emailed around. It was not very sophisticated.
Right. So the world has changed for the SQL Server users and for the developers using the data platform. So we've got SQL Server in the cloud. We've got SQL Server on-prem. We've got SQL Server on Linux, in mm-hmm. containers, on Kubernetes. We've got hybrid approaches, and then we've announced SQL database on the edge for edge devices. Mm-hmm. And so with all of that, SSMS is a wonderful tool. My team works on SSMS and continues to work on SSMS, but it is a Windows-only tool, mm-hmm. and it's not going to be flexible for all of these new ways of working with data. As well, what you mentioned about having the SQL files that you're just kind of passing around also doesn't really scale to the way that people work these days. Mm-hmm. So to that end, we've been working on some new tooling approaches, and one of the most important things to come out of our tooling group lately has been Azure Data Studio. Mm-hmm. So Azure Data Studio is a downstream fork of VS Code. So you know VS Code is cross-plat and all of the goodness that comes with that. And so it's a downstream fork of that. It's integrated on a daily basis. It releases every month. And the VS Code, shell, it adds a lot of connectivity to Azure data properties like SQL Server, all the different editions of SQL Server, Postgres, et cetera. So it is a tool that you install on your dev environment, but then you're able to connect to all of your servers wherever they are, and you can do it from Mac, you can do it from Linux, you can do it from Windows.
So Azure Data Studio is the next evolution of data management on every platform now, not just Windows. So it'll do all the things I'm used to doing. It'll connect to SQL Server and run .SQL files, mm-hmm. and the stuff that I use SQL Management Studio for, mm-hmm. plus a whole lot more that we're going to learn about today.
Yes, exactly. So the thing that I really wanted to talk about today was, as you mentioned, Jupyter Notebooks and how we're using them in Azure Data Studio. So mm-hmm. you're familiar with Jupyter Notebooks, I presume.
Yeah, my team works on .NET Interactive, mm-hmm. And Jupyter, I know, has this concept of a kernel. Even mm-hmm. though I think about Jupyter and Python, mm-hmm. there's this kernel, this runner, mm-hmm. and right now we've got .NET, C# and F# can mm-hmm. run. So you make interactive paper. Mm-hmm. You mix prose and code.
Exactly, and so this is something that we saw really jiving with the problems and the needs of our data users. Because if you think about the way that people deal with their troubleshooting scripts, et cetera, they were just handing around SQL files, and then they were just handing around CSV files. And these things were all disconnected from each other. So mm-hmm. if I may, I'll show you a little bit of what our viewer is.
Please.
For that in the tool. And so here in Azure Data Studio, we do have the ability to create both queries and notebooks. So if I just do like a new query, this is probably what you're used to. I'm going to hit connect. I'm going to pick my local hostess machine, and I can do select star from sys.databases and run that, and I get my results. Mm-hmm. And so this is kind of the SSMS way and the way that most people are used to it. But when I save this, if I control S save this, what I'm getting is a .SQL file, and it has no comments unless I've actually added comments.
It's literally just a text file.
It's just a text file. Yeah. So supporting SQL 2019, we had a need to add something more robust for the SQL Server 2019 big data clusters, which allow Spark, and you had the need to do Python. Mm-hmm. So the first thing that we did is we added kind of a traditional SQL notebook, or a traditional notebook non-SQL, which supported Python. So this is just kind of a little light one that I've created that uses the dog API to pull down a random image of a corgi. Okay. And so this is using a Python kernel. And you can see here we've got a number of other kernels mentioned. And we've got PySpark, Scala, R, Python, PowerShell, and SQL are shipping in the product. So what's that SQL kernel for? This is something that we've added in Azure Data Studio to give that full fidelity of the SQL mm-hmm. experience that you get in the query editor in a Jupyter notebook.
Okay.
So close that one out and kind of show you a comparative experience. So let me start a little blocking scenario here. I'm going to start a 5-minute block. And so this is, I'm doing a transaction, one of them is updating the same table as another, and they're going to be blocking each other. So let's say that my DBA has this, you know, detectblocking.sql file, and they run that, and I pick the place to run it, and I run it, and now I've got this output, and now I see this, but if I want to share this with somebody else, I'm probably having to type an email to say, this is the query I ran.
Because you want to share the context.
Right. You want to know the context. Where did it run? When did it run? What was the situation? What were the results?
Yeah.
All of that.
And an email with a bunch of attachments is very disjointed. I mean, here's a bunch of attachments, and number of attachments. Could be one, could be 20.
Right.
And then a bunch of pros, and then what is the format now, the email?
Right, exactly. And then let's say somebody wanted to continue working on that. They're taking those disparate pieces and reconstructing them into mm-hmm. something to work with. So if I compare that instead to a notebook, this is a SQL notebook. And what I've got here is I've actually collapsed all the cells. Let me expand all the cells. And you can see I've got all the SQL that I need, including that diagnostic query, interleaved here with some light descriptions of what it is. So if I run this same thing on here, I've now got a number of other pieces of information embedded in this artifact that I can send to somebody. So let me scroll up here, and I can see, OK, this is the uptime information for the server. These are the weights, and here are some other information about the stored procedures that are running, the query statistics, etc. I can save this, and if I just hit Control S, save, and close that, if I go over here and just reopen it, the diagnostic queries, mm-hmm. it's going to have all of that information still in there. So the next person that I send it to is also going to, see if I double-clicked wrong. The next person I send it to is going to be able to open it and immediately start working on it. Mm-hmm. So this is...
Where are the connection strings at that point, though?
So the connection strings, you still, just like anything else in SQL Server, you would just choose to connect them. So it basically...
So connections are a thing, just like they are in SQL Management Studio. So mm-hmm. if you have the... You can look at the pros, you can look at the queries, but the connection string isn't shipped along with the book.
Correct. So, and that's kind of a security consideration.
Well, it makes sense because the book can be generic as well, mm-hmm. not specific to it.
Exactly. And so one of the things that we started hearing about was the desire for people to create collections of these to say... Say you have your very senior DBAs and they have all of their special scripts and everything. They can combine them up into notebooks and then they want to make them available to the rest of the IT department. They mm-hmm. make them available to say, when this happens, do X. When this happens, do Y.
Are these then source code appropriate artifacts?
Yes, and so you can check these in with Git. You can check them into your source code as the IPYMB files. And then as we talked to users and they were excited about this concept, we realized something kind of interesting, which is that's what we at Microsoft do. So our engineers within SQL Server also have all of these special troubleshooting books. Mm. We're calling them books now, but they have all these troubleshooting SQL files, and they were kind of floating around. You know, they're in repos here, they're in emails there, they're in OneNote there. And these are the things where if you got an escalation from a customer, somebody would find this kind of magic script that lived somewhere and make sure that got back into a support case, et cetera. And it was kind of dribs and drabs, and it wasn't sharing it universally. So what we've decided to do is use this open source concept called a Jupyter Book and actually ship those scripts that we have internal to Microsoft to the customers within the product.
So a notebook is prose plus runnable cells of language, in mm-hmm. this case SQL, mm-hmm. and a Jupyter Book is a collection of notebooks.
Correct. And so it's a collection of notebooks with table of contents and cross-linking through them.
Okay.
So here I'm going to bring up our command palette, Control-Shift-P, and go to Jupyter Books SQL 2019 guide. And so what that's doing is, if I go over here to my books viewer, I've now got this table of contents, and I've got my list here. And these are the actual troubleshooting guides that we use internally to Microsoft. So if I go to troubleshooters here.
Troubleshooting things of all kinds.
Of all kinds. And so here I've got the big data cluster, which is the new SQL 2019 SQL Server with Spark. And I can go to the troubleshooter for that. And it's got a notebook here. And this notebook has suggestions of other notebooks that I might want to click in on. So here I'm going to go to this one, say what's the version information. And if I look at each of these cells, it's actually got the Python code, in this case, that would be run if you did a support case with Microsoft. And so you can run this yourself and see if you can get what you need out of it. And if not, you've got everything you need to open a case or to bring it to the community, et cetera. And so that's how we're trying to get this information out there. We figure that there's no reason to keep this information internally. The other thing that we're doing is we're actually building this with SQL Server. So you asked if this was, you know, source code type.
Yeah.
So this Python that we're writing and these notebooks that we're writing are actually being used as tests of SQL Server. So when you run a build of SQL Server, it's running all these notebooks as gated check-in tests.
So this isn't just a random bit of documentation that you don't care about that you've thrown over the wall. Mm-hmm. This is the product itself. It's integrated with both SQL and now shipped with Azure Data Studio.
Correct. And so with it being shipped in Azure Data Studio, it has the ability for us to push updates to it as we have changes. Let's say we, from build to build, a DMV changes if you're on a different version of SQL Server. We can make sure that troubleshooting is kept up to date. And so that's for how we're sharing it with the community, and we're going to be doing it through GitHub, et cetera. Yeah. We've got a number of other ones here where our SQL Server samples repo, for example, is now investing in putting demos of how to use new features into notebooks so that you can choose to run them and try it, if you think about how samples always worked.
Right.
Or you could say, I don't want to run it. I want to just run through and see what the results were when they ran it. So I can actually see the results as they were run in our lab and take a look at it and say, oh, that's what would do if I wanted to try this feature. And you can kind of either run it in your local environment or not. So that's kind of how we're getting Jupyter Notebooks really embedded into the way that we want to communicate about new features, about troubleshooting features, and helping users to create their own artifacts of that kind.
So we want people to understand that Jupyter Notebooks, it's not just for big data anymore, right? Mm-hmm. It's not just Python. It's any number of languages that you have a Jupyter kernel for, in this case, SQL. And this is not just, this isn't an experiment. This isn't a little thing you're trying out. When we said all in during the introduction, SQL Server is all in on Jupyter Notebooks. This is the way to do things.
Absolutely. I mean, we are now using it in our own build pipeline. So we are all in on it, even for our own internal purposes. And so certainly for the external customers, we are going to be committed to this. We view notebooks as both a way of doing data work and actually just as a new interactivity method. Mm. And so as an example of that, I want to show you another way that we're using notebooks. And the idea is to use a new deployment. So here I want to do a deployment of SQL Server in a container.
Okay.
So I'm going to pick SQL 2019, hit select. I'm going to just put a default password here. And put it on a port that I know is not in use, hit open notebook. So rather than going through a full wizard experience, I can now kind of spit out the code that you need to do something and to operationalize it within a notebook and let you run with it and make changes to it and do everything you need instead of hiding everything behind a click-through wizard.
Mm-hmm. So this is the nice thing about the new Microsoft, is not everything is necessarily hidden behind a wizard here.
Right. Right?
And at this point, it's just a text file.
Mm-hmm.
And ultimately, you can go down and see what's really going on. There's nothing hidden.
Mm-hmm.
And we have this now. Everyone can do this. So people who are watching and are like, what? I've never heard of this. If they have Azure Data Studio, they probably have all these things available to them today.
Yes. So all that they really need to do is go over and download and install Azure Data Studio. It's available if you just kind of search on Bing. You can find it. Or you can go over to our GitHub repo. And from there, you can get access to the insider's build, similar to as you would do with VS Code.
Very cool. So all in on Jupyter Notebooks and Azure Data Studio.
Yes.
Buckle up, data friends. There's a lot of great stuff happening, and I'm learning about it today on Azure Friday.